God who stretched the spangled heavens. 771.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you sent your Holy Spirit to the life and light of your church. Open our hearts to receive the riches of your grace, that we may be ready to receive you wherever you appear. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The congregation may be seated. We invite all children, young and old, to come forward for the children's sermon. Buddy, come on up. Yeah, come on up. We've got room for everybody. We're going to need to do a little bit of Lutheran scrunching. Leland, can we do that? Perfect. Welcome, dear friends. Set to go then. So, my dear friends, you are all, of course, growing and mature and getting bigger and bigger every day. It's hard to believe. But can you remember a time when you were little? Anybody here remember a time when you were little? Yes, yes. Who will admit it? Well, raise your hand. I once was little. Yes, anybody? Yeah. Should we check and see if the grown-ups remember? Was there a time when you were little? Can you show us a hand if you remember a time when you were very, very small? Okay, good. So we've all been there, right? Sometimes it can feel when you are little like you don't count, like nobody's looking out for you because I'm just little, who cares about me? And on days like that, it is worth remembering that Jesus especially looks out for us when we feel little and small and unimportant. And we're going to hear special words Jesus had to say to a bunch of people who'd be feeling very, very afraid and unimportant because they're very, very little. And he says, don't be afraid. You are so precious and beloved by God. God's going to give you the whole kingdom, so don't you worry. It made me think of a story I found this week, and I wanted to share it with you if you would be willing. Would that be all right with you all? We'll consider this a biblical commentary on Luke chapter 12, which just happens to go by the name You Matter. Is that all right with you all? So this goes like this. For anyone who isn't sure if they matter, you do. The small stuff, too small to see, like if you're looking in a microscope. Those who swim with the tide, and those who don't. Look at this guy all by himself over here. The first to go, and the last. You matter. When everyone thinks you're a pest, like a mosquito. When something is just out of reach, look at that dinosaur, this little tiny hands he can't scratch up. When everyone is too busy to help, you matter. If you fall down, if you have to start all over again, even if you are really gassy, like the sun, you matter. Sometimes home is far away. Sometimes someone you love says goodbye. Here's the person there waiting for their mom who's on that rocket ship. Sometimes you feel lost and alone, like, look, this dog is all lost. But you matter. Old and young, people chasing after a dog, people who look like they've got a few decades of life on them. The first to go and the last. The small stuff, too small to see, even the ants of the ground. You matter. I want you all to know that, but I also need you to remember, because sometimes we have to tell that message to people among us who might feel like they're too little to matter. Like today, a really, really special thing is going to happen. Anybody know what the special thing is that's going to happen today? Jason Callie got the baby. Do you know what's going to happen today for Emery? No? Okay. Yes? She's going to be baptized, and that's really, really cool. It's a way of us remembering that God says, even when we're very, very little, you matter to me. Sometimes the world of grown-ups thinks, if you're little, you don't count. You don't think you're important until you're older or taller or have gone to more school or richer, things like that. But God says, oh, you matter just as you are. And when we get to celebrate Emery being baptized, it's a reminder to each one of us that no matter how big or how small, how old or how young, no matter where you are in life, God says to you, you, Matt, you are precious. And if you don't happen to have this book handy to remember it,
There's another special thing you can do to remember that you matter and you've been claimed by God. Would you like to find out what it is? Would you come on a quick field trip with me? Come over here. Dun, 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 dun. Here, at the baptismal font, you are always invited, if you want, to take some of that water on there and to trace it in the sign of the cross on your forehead to remember when you were baptized and God claimed you and said, you belong, 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 you matter. If you've ever had one of those days and you think, I'm just too small, nobody's paying attention to me, I'm not important, remember, you are beloved and God's claimed you. So if you don't have that book handy and you happen to find yourself here, you can remember why. You want to try sticking your finger in, see what it feels like? You might as well try. What's it feel like? Yeah. Remember, as sure as you can feel that water, you can come around here if you want to, Jace. As sure as you can feel it on your finger, you know, that's really there. There's really water there. I can feel it. This isn't just empty talk. These are words. I can feel it and I know it. It's almost empty. I'm going to put some more in when it's time for Emily. How about that? So I'm going to give you a perfect. I'm saving it up for just the right moment. As sure as you can feel that water on your hands, God's promise is just that real. And I want you to remember it, no matter when you are this tall, or one day you get super tall like that, anywhere in between, God says, you matter. And part of our job today is to remember that so that when it's our turn to tell that to Emery over there, she'll know it's true. Can we pray together right where we are? Dear Jesus, thank you so, so much for your promise that we don't have to be afraid, that you call us precious and beloved, that we matter no matter how old or young, big or small, any of those other things in our lives, you call us your beloved. Help us to remember it now, both when we need to know it, and help us to remember it to tell others when they need to know it. Thank you for your love, Jesus. We love you too. Amen. Thank you all so much for coming up, everybody.
You have one candle.
One candle, that's right.
The first reading today is from Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 6, a reading from Genesis. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. But Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. Then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm today, Psalm 33, verses 12 through 22, found in the bulletin. We'll read responsibly by the full verse. Happy is the nation whose God is the Lord. Happy the people chosen to be God's heritage.
The Lord looks down from heaven and sees all humankind.
God sits firmly enthroned and watches all who dwell on the earth.
God fashions all their hearts and observes all their deeds.
A king is not saved by the size of the army, nor a warrior rescued by their great strength.
The horse gives vain hope for victory. Despite its great strength, it cannot save.
Truly, your eye is upon those who fear you, O Lord, upon those who wait for your steadfast love.
To deliver their lives from death, and to keep them alive in time of famine.
Our inmost being waits for you, O Lord, our helper and our shield.
Surely our hearts rejoice in you, for in your holy name we put our trust.
Let your loving as we place our hope in you. Here ends the song.
The second reading today is from Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 through 3 and 8 through 16. A reading from Hebrews. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. By faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance, and he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith he stayed for a long time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith he received power of procreation, even though he was too old, and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered himself faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven and as innumerable as grains of sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth, for people who speak in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land that they had left behind, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Outfit or costume looks like. How often is that sort of like just ready, like that. You know, sometimes I'm holding the big Viking hammer, sometimes it's my bow and arrow, depending on your superhero. Maybe you notice how often superhero movies use that classic pose where they all jump out of the helicopter, fly down the line like this, to look really tough, I'm brave, that kind of thing, despite how silly and not really useful that pose might be. We live in a culture and a time that talks a lot about the value of bravery, but my suspicion is often we've settled for sort of a fake version, a Hollywood version, something that isn't the genuine thing, isn't the real thing, and is so quickly all clenched up. When I think about what bravery looks like, what it really looks like to be fearless, I know in my own life, sometimes the pictures that come to mind are, well, for one, sometimes a picture of somebody doing something reckless and fearsome, like somebody who leaps out of a plane to go skydiving and yanks on their parachute, or the person who decides, I'm going to be brave, I'm going to do reckless things like bungee jumping or things like that. You've known people who confuse being crazy with being brave, doing things that are reckless with courage. And while sometimes courage requires you to do dangerous things, just because you're doing something dangerous doesn't mean you're brave. Sometimes it just means you haven't thought things through. But sometimes our wider cultures, yes, you know who's brave because they're the ones leaping out of planes to go bungee jumping, they're the ones like skydiving, maybe, but also maybe that's just reckless. So if you're picturing bravery, it looks like the person who's swinging on the vine like in an Indiana Jones movie or yanking on the parachute cord because they're skydiving, maybe, but maybe that's just fake bravery. Or maybe you picture somebody, you know, looking tough, like often when we were kids at the playground, you could tell who wanted to project the image that they were brave and courageous because they'd be the ones intimidating the other kids. It's awfully easy in this life to assume that being a bully equals being brave, because there's ones always picking fights out of bike rack during recess, there's ones intimidating other kids, there's ones clenching their fists up and making other kids feel afraid. When it turns out the secret most bullies don't want you to know is they're actually deeply afraid and insecure inside and want to make other people more afraid on the outside than they are on the inside and project looking tough by clenching their fists up like that. But that ain't real bravery either. Maybe sometimes we also confuse being brave for just not paying attention. That's a possibility too. Sometimes people aren't afraid of things not because they're very courageous, but because they've just chosen to stick their heads in the sand and aren't even aware or thinking about things that they're already worried or concerned about. So it is possible also in this life to confuse being brave with just pulling the covers up over and going back to sleep. Being apathetic and indifferent sometimes might look like it's brave because you're not afraid of what other people say, just because you're not paying attention to it. I'm going to pull the covers up over my head and not think about it anymore. Let's be clear, though. Whether you are swinging on the vine, pretending that you're Tarzan, thinking you're brave, or whether you are putting up fists to intimidate the other kids at recess, thinking you're brave, or whether you're just pulling the covers up over your head and not thinking about what everybody else is afraid of, none of those are actually brave. That's fake fearlessness. That's empty, shallow, cardboard, one-dimensional courage. Which begs the question again, absent superhero movies and their posturing, absent the other fake versions that we hear in our wider culture, what does it really look like to be fearless? And I suspect the answer that Jesus gives will catch us off guard. I will confess, it has caught me off guard spending time in this scripture over the course of this week, because Jesus' motion, Jesus' description of what it looks like to be fearless isn't where our brains go in a world that's saturated by action movies and superhero stories and plenty of bullies. Instead, Jesus talks about bravery and doesn't clench our hands in the fist, whether grabbing a vine to jump from or a parachute cord or anything like that, or fists to threaten somebody with. Jesus picks bravery opening our hands up, both to receive and to trust that God will give us the things that we need, and then to share with the people around us because we are so grounded in confidence God will give us what we need, that God is reliable, so I don't have to hoard or threaten you or do something reckless to prove how tough or brave or courageous I am. To hear Jesus tell it the posture of being truly fearless looks like open hands, willing to trust God will give me what I need, and willing to share with the person around me that I trust God not only loves me, but loves the person next to me and cares that they have what they need, and God's going to take care of my needs too. That's why it's so surprising and beautiful and sort of catches me off guard to hear Jesus say to presumably this gathering of pretty feeble and fearful disciples, have no fear, little flock. And notice that Jesus doesn't follow that up with, be fearless, you know, intimidate everybody. Or be fearless and go do reckless things in my name. Or be fearless and just pull the covers up over your head so you don't have to think about any of the scary things in the world. Instead, Jesus says, have no fear, little flock. It's God's will to give you the kingdom. So therefore, give generously. Go ahead, sell your possessions. Give alms generously. And care for the people around you. Trust that God will provide what you need. Man, is that sometimes scary kind of advice to live with open hands, trust that maybe the bravest thing you and I can do doesn't look like being a bully at the bike rack in fifth grade. Doesn't look like being an adventure or action hero swinging from a vine or leaping from an airplane. But sometimes the bravest thing you can do, the most fearless thing you can do is to practice generosity. Is to say, who are the people around me that I can trust? God will provide enough for me. I will be generous with people around me. That's what courage just might look like. It's scandalous. It's countercultural. And they have not made a superhero movie that works like that at all. Because Jesus' kind of bravery is so different and yet so refreshingly needed. Because to be honest, I've gotten tired of watching the same old superheroes through a different color scheme and costumes, watching people clutch onto things, trying to save the day and throw punches. To be honest, what we most deeply need is what Jesus has been telling us for 2,000 years, that real bravery, real fearlessness doesn't mean I have to make you intimidated or afraid of me. It doesn't mean I have to ignore what's going on with my clutch and the blankets and pulling them over my head. It doesn't mean I have to be reckless and do something crazy. It means maybe I can dare to be generous. That when people look at the ways we are willing to share what we have, to look out for people around us, they'll go, man, those are people who actually believe God will come through for them. And that, my dear friends, is actually what makes there such good news in the words of Jesus. Because Jesus doesn't just say, go be brave, good luck. Jesus says, you can be brave. You can be fearless. You don't have to be ruled by fear anymore. You can be brave enough to be generous, brave enough to live with open hands, because you can trust God knows your needs and cares for you. God has your needs in mind. When you wake up in the morning, God is already up and aware and working on giving to you the things that you need, and the people down the street, and the people across town, and the people halfway around the world, and people who haven't been born yet. It turns out God is so reliable and dependable, we are free then to open up our hands instead of constantly clutching onto, here's mine, you can't take it, or I've got to threaten you to make you more afraid. None of those things are necessary for people who dare to trust God really is reliable. Maybe that's the question for us to ask. Do I dare to trust that the God I say I believe in is trustworthy? There will come a moment in a little bit in our liturgy where we do that ancient rite of reciting things we believe about God. These are weathered and time-tested things to say about God, so I'm not in favor of getting rid of them. But it's awfully easy sometimes just to recite those words about believing what happened to Jesus or what we believe about the Holy Spirit or the resurrection of the dead, and not to make the final connection of, and I trust this God to give my life to, and I trust this God to give me what I need, and I trust this Jesus when he says that I can live my life with open hands, not constantly fearful about clutching on to what's mine or taking from other people or threatening you because I'm afraid and I don't want you to see that I'm afraid, but living our lives with open hands and deep, confident trust. What I need to ask of you all this morning, if you'll let a preacher ask a favor, is this. I need you all to be voices, not just for each other today, but for all of Emery's life long as she's baptized today, to help her to remember what it looks like to trust God, not simply to recite words in the hymn. That may be a helpful, useful tool as we get to know who this God is that we say we believe in, but not ever to let it just end with, here are things, facts I can recite about God. Teach her that because we dare to believe God is trustworthy, we can live our lives with open hands. And that's measured, and that's seen, that's visible, not just in words we say, reciting them out of a hymnal, but it's shown in the ways we live our lives with open hands. And when we practice generosity, it's in the ways that you and I dare to keep our eyes awake rather than pulling the cover over our heads. The ways we refuse to be bullies to other people and intimidate people. The ways we refuse just to do reckless stuff to make people think we are tough. But the way we dare to trust with whatever you've got available, your time, your talent, your resources, your abilities, to give those generously, trusting God will give me what I need. I can give away what I have. And I don't have to live my life all clenched up all the time. When we try that, when we try to make our lives all clenched up like that, looking so tough or brave, we end up killing ourselves. And Jesus invites us into a way of life that's free and open and deeply, deeply fearless. So, whatever words you will find to tell, and maybe to tell yourself on the days you need to be reminded, oh yeah, not just I believe facts about God, I dare to trust God, I'm trustworthy enough, I can live my life with open hands. Tell one another, remind one another, that's why this God we worship is worth our praise and our lives. God is trustworthy. And if you need words to borrow, maybe here are words for today. A song for each of us and for Emily. Daring to trust the God who claims Emily, who has claimed you, He is worthy of our trust enough to live all our lives with open hands. And when we do, the world will see a strange kind of bravery they were not prepared for in the movies, but the exact kind they most deeply need. Sisters and brothers, on this day and always, live with open hands.
Congregation is invited to rise as you are able to sing hymn number 764, Have No Fear.
Renounce them.
Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God?
I renounce them.
Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to heaven. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, we give you thanks. In the beginning, your Spirit moved over the waters, and you created the world, calling for life, and then you took the life. Through the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family, and through the sea, you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river, your Son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' own death and resurrection, you set us free from the power of sin and death and raise us up to new life. Pour out, your Holy Spirit, the power of your living word, that those who are washed in the waters of baptism may be given new life. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. Henry, you ready?
Ready? It's going to be all right, I promise. And I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. There we go. You belong in Christ, in whom you've been baptized. Hallelujah. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give your daughters and sons new birth, cleanse them from sin, and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Emery with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever.
Amen.
Emery, child of God, you have been marked with the cross of Christ and sealed with the Holy Spirit forever.
So shine before others, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Let us welcome the newly baptized.
We welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Join us in giving thanks and praise to God and bearing God's creative and redeeming word to all the world.
Can I borrow your daughter for a minute? Okay, it is now my great privilege to introduce to all of you the newest member of the body of Christ and sister in Christ among us here in life. This is Emily J. Everybody, this is Emily. Emily, this is everybody. Now, I want you to know, all these people have just made promises to share life with you. They will sing beside you and strengthen and encourage you. They will feed you really good food. They will teach you about God's love. They will pray with you and for you. And they'll walk all through your life's journey with you. They just made that promise. So I want you to get to know everybody first, all right? So everybody, this is Emery, everyone, this is everybody. Okay. Thank you so much for letting me borrow your daughter. This is one of those moments that's perfect for the people of God. And as the baptismal party goes back to their places, the congregation rises as we continue our prayers and love.
continues with the prayers of intercession. Trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come near to the Holy One in prayer. Our response today will be, hear our prayer. Lord, your loving kindness be upon your church. Fill all who proclaim the gospel with your spirit. Equip your flock to speak your word of promise and hope in the midst of fear and uncertainties. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Let your loving kindness be upon your creation. Dwell among us and sustain our earthly home. In peace, in places of famine, provide nourishment. In places of plenty, fashion us to be good stewards of your bounty. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Let your loving kindness be upon your world. Be our helper and our shield in places torn by strife and violence. Raise up courageous leaders to govern with compassion and justice. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Let your steadfast, loving kindness be upon your children. Look upon all who wait for your steadfast love. Console those who grieve and embrace those who cry out to you. Help us to trust your promises and to be not afraid. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Let your loving kindness be upon this community. Fashion our hearts to strive for the ways of peace. Strengthen the outreach ministries of this congregation and all who care for those who are in need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Lord, today we lift up to you Terry, Sharon, Tammy, Mike, Marcia, Jack, Patty's granddaughter, Jess, and we are thankful for Becky and Bob. With thanksgiving, we remember all who died in faith and now rest in you. As they place their hope in you, so strengthen us to trust in your promises of new life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Receive our prayers. Receive the prayers of your children, merciful God, and follow and hold us forever in your steadfast love through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
You're invited to share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
Thank you.
food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts towards those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care, and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Near to those who suffer, beside the sinner, among the poor, with us now. We thank you, O God. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples to eat, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his love for us on the way, at the table and to the end, we pray boldly in the words Jesus gave us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and glory, forever and ever. Amen." You are invited to come to this table with courage, that is to say, with open hands. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. We sing together number 204, Thankful Hearts and Voices Rise. Thank you.
forth and love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.